Hello, everyone, and welcome to Pro Wrestling This Week, television's only wrestling video magazine. I'm Gordon Solie.
I'm Joe Pedicino. What a show we've got lined up for you this week. We're going to see news on an injury to Dusty Rhodes. We've got Hulk Hogan going in the ring against Bob Orton Jr. A six-man battle royal comes your way from the Central States area. The Women of POW will be on today's show, and our feature match for the WCCW World Heavyweight title, it comes from Texas Stadium. The action all starts, though, in Portland, Oregon.
It does indeed, as we're going to watch Mike Miller, who had a rather remarkable transformation last week when he defied the orders of his manager, if you will, the crippler Rip Oliver, and decided that fair play was the better part than victory. Well, Mike Miller is on his own now, and we're going to watch him as he takes on Sputnik.
I was talking to Mike a little earlier today, Barry, and he really feels good about this.
Well, it was his decision, and as a man, he made that decision on his own. And in my opinion, thank God he didn't put a man out of wrestling and cost his whole family, their life.
He could have, if he'd come off that top rope. And Oliver was going to do it. Oliver jumped up there on that rope, and he was going to come down on Coco's leg. And Miller, that's when Miller grabbed him. That's it. The Mike Miller neck breaker. 1, 2, 3. That's it.
Miller, hey, what's this? Look at Oliver.
Wait a minute. What's going on here? Here comes Rip Oliver. And Mike Miller got Oliver with the right hand. He got Cruz with the right hand. Mike Miller's kind of cleaning house in there, but he needs some help, Barry. He's being attacked now by Oliver and Art Cruz. Oh, man. Where's the assassin or somebody? Oh, now Oliver's attacking referee Sandy Barr. They're going to set Miller up now for a vicious beating, Barry.
Come on.
Sputnik comes in with a chair. They're gonna pile drive Mike Miller on that. Here comes the assassin. The assassin. Oh, did he ever nail Rip Oliver right in the back of the neck? The assassin has come in to clean house, coming to the rescue of Mike Miller. Oliver still pounding on Miller, and Miller's gonna be okay. Thank goodness the assassin got there before. Before he was pile-driven right onto that metal folding chair. Cruz is there. Rip Oliver's there. Well, they didn't get the job done. Thanks to the assassin. But I'll tell you, Mike Miller got a couple of shots in there, some really dandies, right in the face of Rip Oliver. And Miller's really, really groggy right now. I wonder if he knows where he is or what's going on. He's backing away from the assassin. It's almost like he doesn't know what's happening. He's backed into the corner. Yeah, he's all right. He's okay. Yeah, all right. I think for a few seconds there, Miller didn't quite know what's going on here. Oh, okay. Oh, don't do that, you guys. Jeez. That's kind of like a high five, only it's kind of a full 10 right into the chest. But they're
Mean Mike Miller with a clean, almost scientific victory over Sputnik. And Gordon, it looks like he may not be all alone after all.
Precisely. It looks like the assassin and others are going to rally to the cause of Mike Miller. I think the die has been cast. We'll be back with more action on pro wrestling this week right after we pause for these words.
Just like a mean billy goat, he butts Kevin Von Erich across the ring and drops him with a body breaker.
At Texas Stadium, the world-class heavyweight title was on the line. And Gordon, what a match that was.
It was indeed. It was a match with Kevin Von Erich, of course, the WCCW World Heavyweight Wrestling Champion, accepting the challenge of Nord the Barbarian. This is indeed our feature match of the week. Let's go to Texas Stadium, the David Von Erich Memorial Championship.
Here comes Nord up to the first, the second rope, up to the top rope of the corner buckle. And flies and misses. Kevin Von Erich with a move just in time. Driving it over the top of Nord. Hammering away. He's got an opening. He's got a chance. Nord on the roll. Up and in, and Nord is body slammed by Kevin. One, two, and not three. The 340-pounder flies underneath. Now watch Kevin from the top rope. A high flying drop kick. Kevin, sensing victory, rolls on top. One, two, but not three again. Nord, his eyes glassy, trying to get out of there. Shaken. Kevin wants to go with the iron claw. He's going to do it again. Another fly. Oh, and he caught right in the foot of the jaw of Kevin Von Erich. Kevin is going to do it one more time, but Nord came up that time and a headbutt to the side. Well, Nord the Barbarian has his opening for about the fourth time in this bout. That's like a mean billy goat. He butts Kevin Von Erich across the ring and drops him with a body breaker, a back breaker. Nord the Barbarian. A little momentum, some more momentum, and a drop across the back with both of those huge legs of Nord the Barbarian. And Kevin cries out in anguish as that pain scorches down his back. Nord and Kevin in the battle for the world championship. Kevin over the back of Nord the Barbarian. Kevin hanging limp in a backbreaker type move by Nord the Barbarian, trying to put Kevin Von Erich, put him away so he has the opportunity to win the championship. The crowd, and Kevin puts the iron claw on Nord the Barbarian. While he's on his shoulder, he slipped the iron claw on Nord the Barbarian. Kevin with the iron claw on Nord. And Kevin, he can't drop him over the top. They both go over the top rope and out. Both of them go flying over the top rope to the floor of Texas Stadium. And the count is on. That was a dangerous move for both of them. Well, they neither would be counted out. Kevin moves the photographer aside, the cameraman aside, and slams Nord in the corner post. The count is on. And Nord is wandering off. The count is on. The bell will be rung. They're both outside the ring. They're both counted out. The battle goes on over on the Texas Stadium floor.
Well, now leaving Texas and the home of world-class championship wrestling, let's journey on to the land of the NWA.
Gordon, an interesting meeting took place last week in the NWA. It was a meeting between two of the top powers of the National Wrestling Association, the superpowers Dusty Rhodes and the Four Horsemen. Tully Blanchard had been claiming to put up $10,000 for a match for the TV title. Dusty Rhodes called his bluff.
And I know the phones have been ringing from wrestling fans all over the country wanting to see this match. So I assume that you would like to see this match take place. But again, we dictate the terms. So Mr. Crockett, if you want to make this match, it's going to cost you upfront money, apart from any purse or any other consideration, just to make the match and to have Mr. Blanchard appear and defend the title, it's going to cost you upfront money, $50,000.
Mr. Dillon's highly irregular to get an appearance money and your normal compensation for wrestling.
Well, that's just how it's going to be.
Jimmy, I got $50,000 here. Let's stop talking about it. The money's here. My money's here. I want the match. Do whatever needs to be done. I want the match. Let's stop talking about it.
Would my check be sufficient?
Please. Okay, my understanding is it's a winner-take-all situation. We're expected to put up the $50,000, so this represents our part of the total purse. That's our $50,000, and I assume that check is good.
Well, now that you have endorsed the check, sort of given up that right to pick much of anything, I have a contract here for your man, Tully Blanchard, to defend the world television title against Dusty Rhodes on June the 6th in Greensboro, North Carolina. For your signature.
There you are, sir. Now the only thing left that I can see is to establish that, in fact, Mr. Rhodes has $50,000 here.
You get your hand off the money. You want the money? June the 6th, Greensboro, North Carolina. You come and get it. Magnum's going to be holding the money.
If it looked like Tully Blanchard was a little overconfident in that meeting, we now know why. As most of you are probably aware, later that week in a match, including Dusty Rhodes, the Four Horsemen jumped in the ring and attacked Dusty, severely injuring that leg once again. Now, we don't know if it's broken like it was a few years ago, but we have been told it was severely injured and that Dusty's status for that June 6th match for the $100,000 winner-take-all is up in the air. We hope to have exclusive interviews next week and bring you more information on the situation between Dusty Rhodes and Tully Blanchard. Now, one of the Four Horsemen were in action this week. We're going to take a look as Arn Anderson goes into the ring. And to be honest, he makes short work of his opponent.
Double A, Arn Anderson. And the Horsemen do strike again, David. We saw exactly what has transpired. We're talking about a lot of money. We're talking about a career on the line with Dusty Rhodes. And you know, not only are the Four Horsemen around, there's Dark Journey holding all that money then.
They say time and time again, the Four Horsemen rule wrestling. They make their own rules. They don't care. And we saw it right there, what they did to Dusty Rhodes.
Well, we'll recall a long time ago when that leg was broken. And then, what a move. And then,
well,
of course, when Dusty lost that world title in St. Louis to play that figure four, the pressure put on it.
This guy's the most sadistic of the bunch.
Yeah. Very well could be. The question is, can Dusty Rhodes recover this time? Not if the Four Horsemen have anything to do with it. There's your winner, Arn Anderson.
Pounds, trying somehow to get out of this.
Pro wrestling this week continues now, and next on the agenda, report on the AWA, Joe.
Jerry, the Crusher Blackwell is making his mark throughout the entire AWA once again. Let's go right now to the Showboat Coliseum in Las Vegas, Nevada, where we're going to see Tony Leone as he goes in the ring against the Crusher.
Oh, the strength of that man. He whipped Tony Leone as though he weighed 100 pounds.
You know, it's nice to take a look. I'm sorry again, Rob, but I can't help it. I like to look at the face here. The gentleman that Jerry just tossed almost out of the ring, and it was just pure shock. Are you kidding me? You picked me up like a rag doll. And now here he's got him again. This has got to hurt.
In a bear hug, Leone, 230 pounds, trying somehow to get out of this hole that's got to be squeezing the breath out of him ounce by ounce until it's completely gone. Leone's going to have to do something with, he can't even get anything on a blow like that. Stick his fingers in the eyes of Jerry Blackwell or something along those lines to break the holder. It may be submission time or this may be all over. Jerry backs off himself and pops him a forearm in the solar plexus and then clubs him, hammers him across the back. Jerry Blackwell can hurt you in so many different ways, and you're seeing ways that he is really, really hurting Tony Leone, who screams in agony at each and every one of those headbutts, elbow smashes, bear hugs, you name it. Jerry Blackwell, what's he going to do now?
Oh! I can feel that from here. That's it.
Tony Leone's eyes are completely closed. He is completely out of it.
Well, I think that match shows in its entirety why Jerry Blackwell is known as the Crusher. Now, we told you last week there was a new AWA World Heavyweight title holder, Curt Hennig. The match was very controversial. Larry Nelson had these words with Curt Hennig this week.
I ask you point blank. Throw out all the nonsense. Did you or did you not receive a weapon of any kind from Larry Zbysko in your match with Nick Bockwin?
Of course not, Larry. I resent you even saying that to me. The championship committee has viewed the tapes over and over again. They have come up with one answer, that Curt Hennig is the heavyweight champion of the world. And if Larry Zbysko would have handed me anything, it would have showed up on the film. Certainly not. Larry Zbysko had nothing to do with it.
Let's take a look at that film right now, each and every one of us, and you tell me what's going on. Here comes Larry Zbysko. What's he doing there?
Well, right here, Larry, I'm knocked out myself halfway here, and what Larry Zbysko is doing at ringside, I have no idea.
Here comes his hand. I want you to explain. Now, watch this very carefully, if you would.
Watch what?
Here he Larry Zbysko.
So he came up, stood at ringside, said a few words to me. I'm not even sure exactly what he said. I was a little bit knocked out myself. I had just wrestled for 20 minutes, and I knew he was there. I looked up at him, and...
Right here. It looks like a possible exchange. Now, Larry Zbysko...
Larry, that shows nothing, in my opinion, and obviously in the opinion of the championship committee, that shows nothing.
Well, it shows Ray Stevens at ringside doing the commentary. He firmly believes that Larry Zbysko handed you a weapon. You got up, you took Nick Bockwinkel out with one punch. That's never been done before.
Well, that's never been done before because Curt Hennig's never been in the ring and had the opportunity. I saw the opening, his chin was wide open, I laid one on the chin, and out he went.
Now, let me understand this fully. You are saying right here, right now, that there is no connection whatsoever of any kind between Curt Hennig and Larry Zbysko.
That's exactly what I'm saying. Larry Zbysko and Curt Hennig have no connection whatsoever. He stumbled up by ringside there, maybe said a few words of encouragement. I'm not exactly what he said, but... I am the heavyweight champion of the world.
I'm wondering if there's a whole lot you do remember about this incident. Things seem to be... Let's talk about your change in style. Not long ago in Minneapolis, an exchange between you and Greg Gagne that was shocking.
Well, the exchange between Greg Gagne and myself, this has been brewing for years and years and years. You know, here in the AWA, it's always been Vern Gagne this, Greg Gagne that. Well, there's been another group of people in town, and they're called the Hennigs. And the Hennigs have been in the AWA in professional wrestling as long as the Gagnes. And all I did in that situation is do exactly what the Gagnes had coming to him. I put him in his place.
Mr. Hennig, a pretty brash young man, and his comments about the Gagnes are bound to have some repercussions. Well, it's time now for the international match of the week, and we travel to San Juan, Puerto Rico, where we're going to watch Las Pastores, the Sheepherders, going up against Keith Larson and Armandito Selgado. And as usual, the Sheepherders create a lot of havoc.
Ahí va, saque de cuerdas. Wow, lo has invertido y doble por parte de ambos pastores contra el luchador Armandito Salgado. Ahí arremete contra él Butch Miller. Y ahí está con una estranguladora de cuerdas contra Armandito Salgado. Violentísima por parte del pastor de Nueva Zelanda, Butch Miller.
Saben, y como de costumbre, Chiqui Star dejó los modales en su casa, vino hasta aquí, nos arrebató el micrófono de las manos y empezó a hacer sus expresiones de costumbre, que sus luchadores son los mejores, aunque en este caso creo que tiene razón, va a ser bastante difícil quitarle la correa a estos dos señores, porque son una máquina de demoler sobre ese cuadrilátero, y ahora mismo el hombre que está dentro de la pareja de los pastores, Butch Miller, es el tanque de guerra, como le llama el compañero Hugo Sabinovich, el hombre fuerte de la pareja, acabando ahí prácticamente con Armandito Salgado.
Bien, mis amigos, y ahí observan ustedes, el encuentro sigue desarrollándose, y ahí, wow, columpiaron en el aire, nada menos que Armandito Salgado, lo columpiaron en el aire, ahí va a entrar Luke Williams al cuadrilátero, ahí viene, saque de cuerda contra Armandito, uy, ¿qué es eso? Le encajaron la cabeza en el estómago de Armandito Salgado, de Luke Williams. Y ahí está dando caratazo contra Armandito Salgado. Butch Miller fuera. Golpe a la cara de Armandito Salgado. Ahí lanzó un golpe a Kim Larson. Por este equipo se metió en el cuadrilátero. Ahí el árbitro manda salir a Kim Larson. Mientras tanto se aprovechan los pastores de Nueva Zelanda. Ahí lo agarra Luke Williams. También va a ganarlo entre los dos. Butch Miller lo mandan en peso. Wow, quebradora obra de cintura. Se sale ahora del cuadrilátero, mis amigos. Luke Williams. Y queda Butch Miller planchando a Armandito Salgado. Y se acabó el encuentro. Victoria para los campeones mundiales en pareja, Pastores de Nueva Zelanda, y ahí están derrotados Kim Larson y Armandito Salgado.
Y entró ahí...
Well, the action continues on Pro Wrestling This Week, and now we're going to go to the Central States area where we're going to see a six-man battle royal. Unusual to see a battle royal match with battle royal rules and only six men. But Steve Estes, Russell Sapp, Steve Siebert, T.C. Carter, Joe Lightfoot, and Vinny Valentino do get into it.
They do indeed, and of course the rule of thumb here is once you're thrown over the top rope, you're out of action. Watch how quickly this happens as we go to Kansas City in Central States Wrestling.
T.C. Carter eliminated from the Battle Royal. In the meantime, Vinny Valentino and Joe Lightfoot double-teaming on Steve Estes. Steve Seibert squaring off, slamming the head of Russell Sapp into that top turnbuckle. Here's a chance for one young man to really propel himself into the ratings here in the Central States.
Well, anytime you win a Battle Royal with so many guys involved, you got a chance perhaps at the Central States heavyweight title currently held by Bulldog Bob Brown. Maybe you can get a partner, get a Central States title shot. A lot of things can happen to a winner.
Wait a minute. Vinny Valentino just tossed Steve Estes over the top. As he did so, Estes's hairpiece came off. It's like Cowboys and Indians. I guess he got scalped,
you,
eh?
I tell you, Rick Stewart, you might say he's pulling his hair out or something like that.
You flip your iris.
All right. That's great. That
it's
great.
A hair-raising situation,
it
I'm sure.
Was. Okay.
Joe Lightfoot pinning Russell Sapp's arm behind his back. Vinny Valentino getting set. It's been a couple of years since I've seen Vinny. He looks good.
I tell you, I'm really impressed with him right now. He's obviously very well-versed in scientific aspects of professional wrestling. He also looks like he's got a little karate in his repertoire, too.
Vinny Valentino now squared off with Russell Sapp as Steve Seibert and Joe Lightfoot continue their battle. Later this hour, of course,
Well, there's a meeting of the minds, not to steal the words of Kevin Wall.
So to speak.
But Vinny Valentino, a little shaken up right here, but I think, hey, there goes Russell Sapp over the top rope.
That leaves us down to three now. Steve Seibert, Vinny Valentino, and Joe Lightfoot. Only a question of time to see who's going to come up with the $700 prize. A cheap shot by Lightfoot.
I tell you what, that really surprised me, Joe Lightfoot right there. Usually he's a very scientific wrestler, but I tell you, when $700 is at stake, Cool Breeze, you'll do a lot of things to try and win that money, including turn on a friend.
Joe Lightfoot now and Steve Seibert double-teaming on Vinny Valentino. Valentino in a bad situation right here, Bart.
Well, I tell you, anytime you're double-teamed, you're in a bad situation. Then I think this is a real test right here. Vinny Valentino can overcome this two-on-one situation.
Wait a minute. Definitely. Lightfoot gets set to get... Whoa!
There's Joe Lightfoot over the top. Oh, there's a drop kick of Vinny Valentino.
Wrestling Video Magazine continues now as our cameras go to New York City.
And time for our Pro Wrestling Illustrated Report with senior editor Bill Apter. He's going to give us the listing for the AWA Top 10, the Pro Wrestling Illustrated Top 10 Most Popular Wrestlers, and some exceedingly interesting commentary about Andre the Giant. Bill, it's all yours.
Is it time for Andre the Giant to hang it up finally retire? Hello, everyone. I'm senior editor of Pro Wrestling Illustrated magazine, Bill Apter. We're going to discuss that, but right now, let's take a look at the ratings for the American Wrestling Association. And now here is Pro Wrestling Illustrated's top 10 list. As reported in our August edition of Pro Wrestling Illustrated magazine, Andre the Giant, in his WrestleMania 3 match against Hulk Hogan, had several opportunities to pin the champion and win the WWF title. But Andre couldn't do it. Andre was just too out of shape. He had no endurance. The Andre the Giant of several years ago could have followed up with his successful maneuvers as he couldn't do at WrestleMania 3, and he could have pinned Hulk Hogan for the WWF title. Andre, it's a very sad story, but you've become a robot for Bobby Heenan at this point. You're destroying your legend. You've got one loss. Why keep going and lose again and again and again? It's similar to what Muhammad Ali did. He just kept telling the people, I just want one more match, and his legend was destroyed. Andre the Giant, you're truly the eighth wonder of the world at this particular time. So let's keep it like this, Andre. Retire. Get out. Hang it up. For Pro Wrestling Illustrated Magazine, I'm senior editor Bill Apter. See you next time.
Well, some strong comments from Bill Apter about Andre the Giant, but I will tell you this. In the WWF right now, one of the rumors going around is the disappearance of Andre the Giant. The word is that he's in a very strong, secret training regiment right now, planning a comeback and another title attack on Hulk Hogan. Another big monster made his debut this week in the WWF as One Man Gang made his first appearance. It looks like Slick has gone out and got the enforcer that he feels he needs to keep him from being attacked by some of the wrestlers in the WWF. And the finishing moves of the One Man Gang prove that he may be just that bodyguard that Slick needs. Now, the WWF champion had a tough time this week. He was in a title defense against Bob Orton Jr. Bob Orton gave him a lot of hard work and a long way to go. Let's go see how the Hulkster came out in that one.
It's rocking and rolling, the hard one, the Hulkster. Uh-oh, look at that. Incredible matchup. Orton turning around just like that.
He's going up. Again, you made reference to the backdrop. The ropes took it away from him.
Two and, no, a kick, all right. Kick out with authority that time.
Set up to the buckle. All fronts to the front. Hulkster to the ropes, coming out and drops the left. One, two, three.
Got him.
Hulk Hogan certainly having his hands full with Cowboy Bob Orton Jr. Well, Memphis, Tennessee has always been a hot spot for professional wrestling, and this week certainly proves no exception to that rule. We're going to watch the Midnight Rockers as they defend their tag team championship against a very aggressive team of Paul Diamond and Pat Tanaka. Let's move on to Memphis.
Drilled him in the throat. Tanaka pounds ahead on the top turnbuckle. Has absorbed considerable amount of punishment, had the presence for a nice reversal and a clothesline on Tanaka. Shawn up to his knees. Marty Jannetty saying, come on, come on, come on. Makes the tag. Here comes Jannetty. The flailing arms of the challengers, delivers two slams, picks them up, slams the heads together. We've got all four in there. The Rockers send them down the tracks to a head-on collision. Paul Diamond pulls down the top rope, and that's going to be a disqualification win. The winners and still the world tag champs on a disqualification, the Midnight Rockers.
Welcome back to Pro Wrestling This Week.
And next on the agenda is our Matt Classic of the Week, and we're going to go back into the mid-50s. former NWA World Heavyweight Champion Wilbur Snyder going up against one of the most infamous of Japanese wrestlers, Mr. Moto. And we're going into that third of a three-fall match.
That's right, Gordon. It's tied one fall apiece. Let's go see who wins this week's Matt Classic.
Mr. Moto forced to break with a throttle hold. And he's being told to break the hold completely. Chops away trying to wear down Wilbur Snyder here. Off balance the ropes again, Mr. Moto. With plenty of time to go, he's got a great opportunity here if he can keep up the wearing down tactics. There's a drop on the throat by Mr. Moto. He's again down on the throat. And it is again the hole that cuts off the breathing of Wilbur Snyder. So again, the break is ordered. Wilbur's in trouble. Mr. Moto slashes away. Look out, Wilbur Snyder pushes the referee off. Wants to handle his own situation. Takes that side headlock. Here we go to the ropes. Back again. Mr. Moto is catching it, and how? Wilbur Snyder, look out, he ran into one. Mr. Moto comes topside of him there. Chopped away at the throat. Puts him down for one and two. And three, and Mr. Moto wins the main event, taking the third and deciding fall here.
Well, Mr. Moto notches another victory. Time now for all of you to have your opportunity to express your views and opinions here on Pro Wrestling This Week. Let's go now to Bonnie Blackstone and sound off.
This week on PWTW Sound Off, Walter N. of Burlingame, California, watching on KVHK, Channel 44 in San Francisco, asks, why hasn't something been done about these managers interfering in the matches? I've seen belts change hands a number of times by the interference of managers and valets. Why haven't they banned them from ringside while the matches are in progress? Well, Walter, you brought up a good point. It seems that more and more promoters are reprimanding and fining managers and valets for the hijinks they create. Not only are fines being applied, but many promoters are finding creative ways of punishing them. A great example occurred in the NWA when Jim Cornette was forced into a cage match with Ron Garvin after Cornette burned Garvin in an earlier match. And Denise R. of Flintville, Indiana, watching on WXIN, Channel 59 in Indianapolis, lets us know, I want to sound off about the local sports reporters. If I'm not badly mistaken, wrestling is a sport, am I right? The local channels never cover wrestling. March 29, 1987 was a record-breaking event in the sports world. 93,173 people turned out to see WrestleMania III in the Silverdome. That does not say anything about the others who turned out to see the spectacular event on closed-circuit TV. But our local TV sports directors did not even see fit to mention it. I wrote to each station's sports director and let them know that I think they should include wrestling in the sports news. Of course, one letter is not good enough. So I'm asking you to ask other wrestling fans to write to their local sports reporters about this. Let them know we mean business. We want our sport included with baseball, football, basketball, etc. Now, if you have questions and comments about the wrestling world around you, send them to us at Pro Wrestling This Week Sound Off, Post Office Box 54556, Atlanta, Georgia 30308. And let us know your station for Pro Wrestling This Week action. I'm Bonnie Blackstone with Sound Off.
Well, our new Sound Off feature is turning out to be one of our most popular features here on Pro Wrestling This Week based on the mail we're getting every week. And as we told you, be sure and tell us the TV station that you watch Pro Wrestling This Week on so we can make sure of what part of the country we're coming from. Right now, we want to go to a junior heavyweight title match in Birmingham, Alabama. Tom Pritchard, the champion, seems to always find a way to thwart Scott Armstrong. This time, Scott thinks he's got it made. Gordon Soley calls the action in this junior heavyweight title match.
Pritchard moving in on his man, lateral press. No, sir, his foot is on the rope. His foot is on the rope. At the count of two, he got that foot up on the rope. Pritchard, badly dazed. To their feet once again. Good block by Armstrong, and Armstrong retaliates. trouble. Automatic disqualification. Automatic disqualification on the part of the referee after the tactics used by Tom Pritchard. And what is Pritchard doing now? Going back into the ring and putting it over the face of Scott Armstrong. And the referee trying to break it up. The referee trying to break it up. Pritchard now, after the referee himself, Pritchard now applying that same cloth and whatever it had in it over the face of the referee. Pritchard bringing up the limp body. Scott Armstrong delivers a pile driver. And Pritchard now punishing Scott Armstrong. Pritchard continues to punish him. Scott Armstrong helpless. And the Nightmares have charged into the ring. The Nightmares have charged into the ring. And Mr. Pritchard beats a hasty retreat. We'll be right back.
News this week from the Universal Wrestling Federation, including new tag team champions. That's right, Steiner and Sting, who won the titles only a few weeks ago in Atlanta, Georgia, have lost the titles to the Lightning Express of Brad Armstrong and Tim Horner. They are the new UWF Tag Team Champions, and we look for a long reign from these two. Their speed and agility will lead them to a long title reign in the UWF, in our opinion. Now, the UWF World's Heavyweight title holder, well, he's doing things a little different. Big Bubba Rogers is now taking on opponents two at a time. Let's go to a handicap match where he takes on the Beach Boys.
I'm sure Devastating Incorporated feels very safe right now in the fact having Bubba Rogers there. Look at him throw his opponent off like he's got a fly on his back. This man is so powerful, so destructive in the ring. I don't know exactly what it's going to take to stop him.
Well, it's going to take something awesome, like maybe a Dr. Death, a Ted DiBiase, or someone along those lines. As the Beach Boys, both of them go down.
There just isn't enough power to be generated by these two young men to knock down Big Bubba Rogers. They're a double clothesline, taking both these men straight to the canvas.
Well, I tell you, at 6'8", 350 pounds, he's one of the most awesome.
Nobody's gonna stop this man, nobody.
Here, General Skandar Akbar.
You see, I'm the greatest. I'm the greatest mind ever. You listen good, T.A. You don't know what I can do, boy.
Well, I know what I'd like for you, for him to do, but anyway. Bubba Rogers bearing the kick to the solar plexus of the young man from California. Big Bubba with a right hand. I'll tell you, he is awesome. What other adjectives can you use? He is phenomenal.
I think what we need to do now is find an adjective to stop the man. It's no doubt that the man is devastating, he is powerful, and he is just destroying men at will inside the ring. I look forward to the day that a man of the caliber of Steve Dr. Death Williams does walk in the ring with Bubba Rogers, because I'd like to see that kind of confrontation. The Big Bubba Slam, there it was.
The Big Bubba Slam was
staying with the UWF for just a couple of more moments. As you remember, one of the most vociferous members of that organization, the Bad Street Man himself, Michael Hayes, last week said that he would deliver some comments this week regarding his comparison of the UWF to the NWA. Well, let's see exactly how Michael Hayes feels about it all.
Wow, you say, what a good-looking dude. That's right, but don't disturb his groove because he is so into you. Whoa, you say his lips ain't moving. I didn't know P.S. was a ventriloquist. I'm not, ladies and gentlemen. I'm live right here in public making your week on Pro Wrestling This Week. And you know, the male thing is still going on. People say, well, what is going on? Where is the missing link? Well, it's obvious he's probably missing. Everybody else says, where's Missy Hyatt? Well, she's probably missing too. I mean, she's probably out gazing the pastures with her family and the whole Borden Corporation, you know, Elsie the cow. Anyway, let's get off and get back to last week's question. The one that everybody wants to know about. talking about the two hottest wrestling organizations in pro wrestling today, the NWA and the UWF. And what's funny is, one, the NWA is the oldest body in professional wrestling, and two, the UWF is the youngest. And they said, what do you think the difference in the wrestlers is? Well, I am not a spokesman for the UWF, but we have been ruling the place for a year, and I'm not going to come out and tell anybody else in the UWF to join the bandwagon, because we never need anybody on no bandwagon. But the NWA ain't come around and challenged any of us, so the Freebirds are kind of like Moses. If you don't take the mountain to Moses, the mountain's going to him. And we're coming to you. I don't care who it is. The Horsemen, Dusty Rhodes, the Road Warriors, anybody. We're coming. My opinion is UWF has got better wrestlers because we're the king. We should know we've gone through them all. So that's my opinion for this week. Matter of fact, we're going to come in. We're going to come in and prove that it is a fact. Later.
Well, Michael Hayes in his opinion, and he is indeed an opinionated person. Speaking of opinions, I must say the ladies of POW are impressive.
That's true, Gordon. It's good to see the Women's Wrestling Association coming around. POW is the name of the program, and we're going to show you a match right now featuring their two top stars. Their POW champion is named Natasha. She's the Russian. Her number one challenger, Nina, and she is extremely impressive. Let's go take a look at what happened this week when these two got together in the squared circle.
It's been pulled down by Jeannie Beret.
Interference from the outside.
Referee Jim didn't see it.
Choke! Choke!
Referee's got to break that up.
Nina should grab the ropes.
She's got to. She doesn't want to put a foot over the rope. Maybe she's trying to take it, Wendy.
She is definitely a dedicated athlete. And Natasha has her hair again.
These are two fine athletes, man.
Choke!
There she is.
Oh, she's distracting the referee. Jeannie Beret's got that Russian flag around Nina.
She is choking her with the Russian flag up and down. The referee should turn around. Natasha is holding him on purpose so her manager can choke her.
This is the strategy of Jeannie Beret and the Russian.
And she still has the flag wrapped around her throat.
It said ring the bell.
I can't believe it.
He rang the bell.
The Russian should be disqualified. Look at her. She won't turn loose of her. She's choking her. She's hanging her in the ring. Nina should have won this match. If Jeannie, the manager, would not have choked her with that flag.
You're going to be heavily fined for trying to choke Nina over the third rope. You had no right.
I didn't touch Nina. I didn't touch her.
My
what are you talking about?
Because of the man.
Everybody here. Sorry. They saw you.
We're the crown, baby. That's where it's going to stay.
Nina had the upper hand in this match.
She still on her head. That's what we came out here to do. And that's all there is to it.
She only won the crown by keeping it through disqualification. The winner of the match by disqualification, Nina!
Us to hit the showers with this episode of Pro Wrestling This Week, but before we go, Gordon, who is the wrestler of the week?
Well, the board studied long and hard. Obviously, the Midnight Rockers were taken into consideration, also Kevin Von Erich. The board decided after the transfiguration, if you will, of Mean Mike Miller last week, and after studying the match this week, that Mike Miller has indeed changed his philosophy about the sport, and so he has been named our wrestler of the week. Let's take a look at the closing moments of that match.
But I'll tell you, Mike Miller got a couple of shots in there, some really dandies, right in the face of Rip Oliver. And Miller's really, really groggy right now. I wonder if he knows where he is or what's going on. He's backing away from the assassin. It's almost like he doesn't know what's happening. He's backed into the corner. Yeah, he's all right. He's okay. Yeah, all right.
Again, our congratulations to Mike Miller. Joe, I guess it kind of proves that nice guys can finish first.
That's right. Let me add my congratulations to Mean Mike Miller. Next week, we have a great show lined up for you. Our international match will go to Japan. We've got a Southeastern Tag Team title match. We'll have an update on that injury to Dusty Rhodes, a Matt Classic, and of course a feature match and much more, all coming your way next week right here on Pro Wrestling This Week. Till then, I'm Joe Pedicino.
And I'm Gordon Solie saying join us again next week for Pro Wrestling This Week.